I think it's real joy to be teaching once again out of the King James Version. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4 right here. We're teaching verse by verse, but we let the Lord lead us. And if he skips and goes through things faster, that's fine with me. I never plan my sermons out. He usually gives me a starting point. Sometimes I ain't even got a starting point, but he always enlightens our eyes and gives us what to do, and I appreciate that. Appreciate his presence. I love the Lord today. I'm glad to be saved and born again, and I know I'm saved and born again. Right here, I want to say this right off the bat. I heard a preacher preach yesterday, and he's probably dead and gone, but I heard a recording, and he preached it line upon line. He preached against sin. He preached hard. Everything. But I just can't feel the presence of God coming out of him. I didn't feel like it come from my father, though it was the truth. I just didn't feel like God was giving it, you know? And I feel sorry for him. But that's the way most people are in the world. They really don't know nothing about the Holy Spirit, about following God in the Spirit and in truth. Paul said it didn't come by word only, but in power right there. So let's look at this. In chapter 4, verse 1, let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God. First, I want to tell you, Paul talks about this mystery all through his writings in Ephesians and Romans and different places. He's talking about that hidden wisdom that was hidden from the foundation of the world right there. And I believe it's the gospel. I believe it's the preaching worldwide, where he goes out and preaches about Christ worldwide, and the Gentiles get saved and they go out and preach, and God broke down that middle wall of partition that was between the Jew and the Gentile, which is the law, and nailed it to his cross, took it out of the way, and said, look, here's the gospel for all. Go out to all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Right there, God wanted to go out to preach to every creature, not just to the Jewish people. And he opened the door through the Apostle Paul to go out to the Gentiles and preach the gospel. And that's what he did. And it was in a mystery. It's always the crucifixion, the name of Jesus, and the times that we're living in grace was a mystery. They didn't fully understand it right there. The Jewish people had no idea that the Gentiles we're going to get saved as a nation and go out and preaching that gospel like they do today. Just plain and simple as that. He said, let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. That means caretakers right there of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required. Notice that right there. He said, it is required. We're stewards of this word. We're stewards of the mystery. We're stewards of the crucifixion of Christ and the preaching of the crucifixion, the word of God which we held, we're required stewards of the Lord, that a man be found faithful, full of faith, and faithful and obedient to the word of the Lord right there. Now, there's a lot of obedient people out there when it comes to the word of God, but the thing about it is, it's not real. It's not, you can't feel the Holy Spirit. It's not in love right there. They're doing it because their preacher done it, and they think that's the way it needs to be done, and they're just repeating what a preacher's saying and acting like their pastor, or acting like they're something they should be instead of what God wants them to be, and letting the Holy Spirit take over. They're just full of the flesh right there, trying to preach the gospel. You can't get nobody saved like that. You can't get nothing done for the Lord right there. And as you get closer to God and you start learning more about the Holy Spirit and fellowshipping with Him and everything, you can start seeing these things more clearer. Just because they say they're preachers, that don't mean they're right with God. Don't even mean they're saved right there. I'm not saying that these preachers are not saved, but I'm just saying that I don't feel the Lord coming out of them right there. Though they're preaching the truth line upon line, I want to feel something from heaven come out of their soul right there and preaching through them You can hear God. If you're a child of God, you can hear the voice of the Lord through His children. Just plain and simple, you can feel God through His children. Right there, it's just plain and simple as that. He says in verse 3, "But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you, or man's judgment. Yea, I judge not my own self." Let me tell you something right there. What I believe that really means is, this ain't Paul's judgments. This is the Lord's judgment right here. It says, "For I know nothing by myself." That's right. I don't know nothing about this word. The Holy Ghost is teaching me this word, and He's doing the judging through me and the preaching through me, and it's Him doing it, not me. It says, "For I know nothing by myself, yet am I not hereby justified, but He that judges me is the Lord." Right there. And I want God to judge me. Right there. I don't mean come down and just bring His wrath upon me. Right there. I want the Lord to try me and judge me right there. And the Bible says we ought to judge ourselves, that we won't be chastened of the Lord. Right there. He says, "Therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes." That don't mean we can't judge people and judge matters. The very next chapter, Paul preaches that throw such a one that's committing fornication with his mama, his stepmama right there. He said, get together and throw him out of church right there. And in the sixth chapter, he says, get those that are least esteemed in the church to judge the matters. You know, so he's saying judge the next few chapters. So he's not saying you cannot judge. This is some deep thoughts right here of Paul, and sometimes you just got to leave it alone if you can't totally understand it. He says, "Therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness." Right there, everything we do in secret, God's going to bring it up with His fiery eyes at judgment day for the saints. The Bible said they call it the judgment seat of Christ. We won't be judged with the unsaved at the white throne, but we'll be judged at the judgment seat of Christ right there. And He's going to bring all the hidden things up. The Bible says we're going to be judged for every deed done in the body, whether it be bad or good. Therefore, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men right there. We're going to have to give an account to God. And He's going to look down on our soul with His fiery eyes and burn out all the dross. And what's left over, like I keep telling you, what's left over, that means the gold, the silver, the precious stones right there is what's going to be left over. That's our good works. And we will receive a reward for those things right there. It's just plain and simple as that. He says, and let me read verse 5 again. "Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsel of the hearts." Notice that right there. "And then shall every man have praise of God." No man has praise of his own self. We're here to glorify the Lord, even at the day of judgment and the judgment seat of Christ. "And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself and Apollos for your sakes, that ye might learn in us not to think of men above that which is written, that no one be puffed up for one against another." Right there. It ain't God's will for us to be puffed up one against another, for one thing. And Paul, you got to read real closely in this fourth chapter. This is kind of deep, and you can't always understand what he's trying to say, but I believe what he's trying to say here is that me and Apollos, me and Barnabas, me and Apollos, me and Timothy, whoever, right there, has suffered for y'all, that you may reign as kings, right there. We fought the battles, that it may be clear that y'all can just reign in peace. And I believe that's what he's talking about, right there. He says, "For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it? Now ye are full." Notice this right here. "Now ye are full. Now ye are rich. Ye have reigned as kings without us. And would to God that ye did reign, that we also might reign with you." Right there, I believe he's talking about that he's did all the footwork. he suffered for the Corinthians that they might have it easy right there. And God used him to do all the footwork and really grind and plow, and that they may, you know, have it made right there and reign as kings. He says, for I think that God has set forth us the apostles last. Why did he say last? I compare that to the prophets right there, to the people of the children of Israel right there, and Abraham and Isaac and all them. They sort of was first, and then here comes the apostles last right there, as it were appointed unto death, for we are made a spectacle unto the world, as somebody that just shined out right there to the world and to angels. Notice he said, and to angels and to men right there. So they become a spectacle to the world right there. I mean, they're the first ones that went out and preached this gospel, and they had to go through some hard times to get there, that the others may have it easy. It's just like in America. We got it easy over here. We can go out and preach the gospel, and you know what I mean? People can't throw us in jail or nothing like that. And it's just, they paid the way. You know, somebody paid the price that we may have freedom in America. Thank God. And that's sort of like what Paul is saying here, I believe, that he's paid the price. He shed blood for the name of cross. These people right here didn't have to get stoned to death and beat to death, and you know what I mean? But Paul paid the price to get this gospel to them. He says, we are fools for Christ's sake, but ye are wise. We are weak, but ye are strong. Ye are honorable, but we are despised. I believe that's what he's talking about, the same thing. Over and over again, he's trying to make sense of it. That they've suffered, that they may, the Corinthians can reign. Even unto this present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and are naked, and are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling place. Look at that. Wow. To get the gospel out, they've both hungered, they've thirst, they're naked, they are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling place right there. They're on the road, they're walking, they're riding, whatever it takes. Sometimes they had to go without food. They wasn't even properly dressed. I don't believe they were jaybird naked, but they was cold. They had to suffer certain things right there. All these Corinthians didn't have to suffer this, but they did this for the cause of Christ, that the Corinthians might reign as kings right there and bless them. And that's how I want to be right there. I'm doing the footwork for my family, for my friends, right there. I'm trying to lay a way for them right there, that they may come, and it will be a lot easier for them. He says, and labor, working with our own hands, being reviled, we blessed; being persecuted, we suffered it. We had to be persecuted. Well, we had to take a lot of stuff. We had to turn the other cheek right there. Being defamed, we entreated. We are made as the filth of the world, and are the offscouring of all things unto this day. Right there, they paid the price to get the gospel out there, that they may win Christ, and they may win souls in the Corinthians, and then make it a lot easier on the Corinthians and on the Galatians and on the Philippians. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved son, I warn you. Notice that. How is he his beloved son? Because, let's just read this a little further. For though ye have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet ye have not many fathers. Notice that right there. There's not many fathers right there. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Notice that. He begotten them spiritually through the gospel. He was their father in a sense in the gospel. And there was his sons. He won them to the Lord. He begotten them through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, beg you, be ye followers of me. Now, Paul the Apostle had enough confidence in his preaching and his living right there that he could actually make that statement and says, just follow me. I'm following Christ right there. Do the things that I tell you to do. It says, for this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son. Notice that. He won him to the Lord. He begotten him through the gospel and made him beloved son. He was a faithful minister of the Lord. At one time, he sent him to Ephesus to teach them the right ways of the Lord right there. And now he's sending them to Corinth. You know, so you got to think about those types of things. And faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you unto remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ. Notice that, my ways that be in Christ is your ways in Christ Jesus. Are you living for the Lord right there? Is your life pleasing to God? Paul said his life was pleasing to God as far as his beliefs and far as what he's practicing right there, but he knew that his flesh was still wretched. That's why he said in Romans there, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God it's through Christ Jesus our lovely Lord. As I teach in everywhere in every church," right there. He opened up many, many churches that's not recorded in the Bible. Now, there's proof that he opened up many churches, but we only see some of them, like the Corinthian church, and then we see the church of Galatian, and then we see the Colossae, and we see different churches in Philippi. But you know what? Think about when he went to Macedonia, he covered all that territory. When he went up into Phrygia, that's when he started Colossae and Laodicea and Hierapolis and probably many churches. He said, "I went through Galatia and Phrygia and encouraged all the brethren in those different churches right there." So he started different churches in the same country, but there's only a few of them that made it in the Bible that we know of, but there's hints of it in the Bible. And he wrote many different letters, and there's hints of it in the Bible, but we don't have those letters. But there's scriptures that let you know that he wrote different letters. I believe Paul was a good writer, and he got people to write for him because he could not see very well. God allowed Satan to buffet him that he won't be lifted up above measure right there by the abundance of revelation that was given unto him. That was a thorn given to him by Satan in the flesh, and that was his eyesight. And finally got to where he had to get other people to write those writings, except when he wrote the churches of Galatia right there. That means there was many churches in Galatia, not just one, but the churches of Galatia right there. And you add S right there to that, and he wrote that letter himself. I do believe that, because he said that. You see how big of a letter that I've written unto you? I believe he means the words were big, because he couldn't see real well, because it was only six chapters right there, so it wasn't as big, you know, like Corinthians and like Romans. They're big, and like Hebrews, them are big writings right there. Them a lot. That's a lot of writings right there. So I believe he took personally and wrote those things with his own hands right there in Galatia. He says in verse 12, let's just read from verse 12. "And labor working with our own hands," we know Paul was a tent maker. "Being reviled, he blessed. Being persecuted, we suffered it. Being defamed, we entreated. We are made as the filth of the world, and are offscouring of all things unto this day. I write not these things to shame you." Notice that. He loved these people. He didn't do it to shame them or to hurt them. He wanted to help them right there. "But as my beloved son, I warn you. For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you don't have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. For this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is a faithful and beloved son." I know I've read this, but I've got back cracked. But that's okay. Mouth's getting kind of dry. I want to cough, and it's distracting me just a little bit. But the Lord's still here with me. Thank God for that. And the devil always wants to try to stop you. I'm here to tell you. He wants to tear us down and beat us down right there. We just got to keep fighting through it right there. Sometimes when you're sick, go out there and preach the gospel anyway right there. I had pains and things, like my foot was hurting real bad one day, and I went out there to preach, and my foot just went numb. You know what I mean? I couldn't even feel no pain. And my back, I went and preached with my back hurting right there, and when I get up there and preach, it goes numb. I don't even feel the pain. That's the hand of God right there. He's having mercy upon us right there. And, you know, the lights went out on my pastor one time. And he just kept preaching. The lights went out and he just kept preaching because the Holy Spirit kept preaching. The lights went out on me one time when I was at a radio station. And I believe they actually cut it off out of despite. It was the devil. And I put it together. And I believe it was just the devil right there, you know. And I just kept preaching right there in the dark. I had a little bit of light, but I kept preaching right there in the dark. It says, now some are puffed up as though I would not come unto you. So there was people that got mad and puffed up at Paul. And there was people in this church that somebody come by and told them lies, and they believed those lies. He even talks about that in 2 Corinthians. They said they was reprobates, and they said they was this and that and other. And some of the people believe that foolishness right there. Those are so-called Christians, or Christians that never grew in the Lord right there. And that's what happens to most Christians right there. They never grow in the Lord, and they just go with every wind of doctrine coming along, and then somebody says something about somebody, and they just go along with it, you know, and they strive. And that sometimes they don't even realize they're striving against the Lord in situations. You got to wait on the Lord. You got to follow the Lord. You got to listen a little bit and let the Lord speak to you and make sure you're not fighting against God. It's just plain and simple as that. I'm real careful. Like I was told you, I listened to that preacher, and I was rooting for him, you know, and I wanted, because he really preached the truth and line upon line, but I just didn't feel the Holy Spirit in it. I felt like, you know, it was sort of like he was just doing it for show. Right there, that he just did it because he thought that's the way it's supposed to be done. But there wasn't no Holy Spirit there. And you ain't going to get nothing done. I don't care how hard you preach, how loud you preach, how much you shout. If the Lord ain't in it, it ain't him. It ain't going to help nobody. It's plain and simple as that. If you don't feel God in your preaching and your teaching right there, it ain't of the Lord. It's plain and simple as that. If you can't feel God bringing it out, something's wrong with your preaching. I'm not saying you're not saved. Something's wrong. If you can't feel God's presence when you're preaching, you're not really preaching in the Lord. That's just plain and simple as that. It says, for the kingdom of God is, let me read verse 19. But I will come to you shortly. Notice that. And he did. He come to him. I think he stayed 3 months. I got it backwards on a recording. I said he stayed a year and a half. That was the first time, I do believe, that he stayed a year and 6 months, the first time he come to Corinth. But then he stayed, at the other time he come to Corinth, after this, he stayed 3 months. He came and stayed a season. I'll have to look that up to make sure I'm right about that. But he stayed for 3 months right there. He loved the Corinthians. But Paul, once he got established right there and sent people there like Apollos and like Timothy and different ones, and he did some things in the book of Acts that you don't even realize when you read the book of Acts. You've got to look closely at Paul's journeys and everything, and you'll find out that he left Timothy and Silas up at Thessalonica for a while, you know, in Athens and different places, you know. He talks about that. You got to look at the scriptures real closely when it comes to Paul's writings, and when any kind of Paul writing, you got to really look at it, pray over it, and really watch what he says, each sentence, because you'll miss so much right there. You'll miss the whole thing, and you'll be reading it for years and miss it every time right there. And you got to watch out for that right there. You want the full counsel of God. You want God to instruct you, and that you won't be ignorant about the word of the Lord. We all been ignorant about God, and when we preach, we make mistakes when we say certain things, you know, as far as so-and-so's names, and we don't realize them when we're preaching, because we're under demonstration of the Holy Ghost, and we're saying a lot of things, and sometimes it don't come out right, and we don't even know it until after we go back and listen to those recordings and stuff like that. And, you know, don't hold it against me if I get it backward sometimes. All preachers do, and they'll tell you in a heartbeat. It ain't that I'm misinterpreting the Bible. Sometimes I don't get the name right or the timeline right, and I don't even realize that I've said it like that. But when I go back, I'm like, that wasn't it. I didn't say the right time right there, or I didn't say the right name right there. And that'll happen to anybody. It says, But I will come to you shortly, if the Lord will. Notice that he said, if the Lord will. And we always say, if the Lord will, we'll do this and that. And really mean it. You know, if the Lord will, we'll do this and we'll do that. And we'll know not the speech of them which are puffed up, but the power. I believe he's talking about the power of God. Let's look at this. For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. Notice that right there. That's powerful. Just because you're preaching the word don't mean you're of the Lord. Don't even mean you're saved. And if you are saved, just because you're preaching the word of the Lord don't mean it's coming from the Lord. You can't preach unless you be sent by God. It's just plain and simple as that. And it's got to be done with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. To get anything done for the Lord and precious souls really, really truly born again right there, it has to be done in power. And it ain't got to be loud, and it ain't got to be shouting to be done in power. As long as the Holy Spirit's doing the preaching, even if it's softly right there, it's going to get somebody saved. It's going to do what it set out to do right there. It's plain and simple as that. So the power of God's going to know who it is that's puffed up and the speech of them that are puffed up. And he says, what will ye? Shall I come to you with a rod? Shall I come and just chew you out in the Lord? And sometimes God allows you to do that. Or in love? Should I just come in love? And I say this. You come in what God leads you to do. Don't go in there and just blast somebody unless it's the Lord. And I've learned this. You don't never plan to blast nobody. And you just plan to let God have his way right there. I try to avoid blasting people unless God gives it. You know, I've learned discipline a little bit in my preaching, because just like I told you, that man that was preaching yesterday, he was blasting and he was tearing people down, but there was no unction from the Father. And he wasn't allowed to say that. If there's not an unction from the Father, he was either not saved or he was preaching in vain. Though he preached the truth, he was preaching in vain. It's just plain and simple as that. If you get close to God, you can tell when those preachers are not preaching in the Lord. You know what I mean? It says, for what will ye? Shall I come to you with a rod? That means getting on to them, like chastising them. Or in love? And in the spirit of meekness. I'd rather come in the spirit of meekness and love. But if God rebukes them, that will be right. And I'll know it, because it's going to take the Lord to cause me to rebuke people. That's something I've learned to try to avoid. Not that I'm trying to soften up or nothing like that, but I don't want to do it in my flesh. I let God do it right there. And you'll be a better preacher if you'll just let God take over your preaching and tell you what to preach. Yeah, you might study a bunch of stuff, but that might not be what God wants you to say when you get there. Just let him have his way and just say, Lord, I'm your free man. Just whatever. I've been studying this right here, but Lord, you bring it out the way you bring it out. And you ain't got to worry about it if you're trusting the Lord to bring it out, if you're saved and you're right with God, and God will bring this thing. If you'll just trust him, he'll bring it out of you. He'll still bring your remembrance. He'll tell you when to stop. He'll tell you when to start. I mean, he's not dumb. He can communicate with his children right there. God has a certain way to communicate with his children. He brings things to your mind. It bubbles up in your heart. The Spirit of God will bear witness with it. His Spirit don't bear witness to a lie right there. But I believe I'm through with this chapter. I appreciate you listening right here. And we will make a, Lord willing, a chapter 5 right here. But we appreciate, I hope I could help you in that. That's a very complicating chapter. It's so little, 21 verses, but it's kind of, there's a few things in there that's kind of hard to understand. I don't have a full understanding of it all. And I've learned, just don't say nothing if I can't understand it. Just keep my mouth shut and let God enlighten my eyes and lets me speak it right there. But we appreciate God's great mercy. Appreciate you listening. I love you today. I want you to be blessed of the Lord. And I hope to see you in heaven. In Jesus' precious name, amen.